Hello, and today my name is Sveta Smirnova, and today we will be talking about my school performance for DevOps. At first, I want to introduce myself. I'm my school support engineer with more than 10 years of experience. I'm author of book My School Troubleshooting. I have few hobby projects on GitHub, and I'm frequent speaker. Idea of this topic raised by various communication between people who use MySQL but who are not DBA and who uses like either from like actually it was from different time and from different people. It could be application developers, it could be system administrators. And today now people who actually wear many hats like who called DevOps. Another thing which raised me for this topic once I was talking like I was talking about interviewing someone to for a support team for working with MySQL and actually we in support we know a few things, few very clear things about which hardware should MySQL use, which hardware options, which MySQL options by itself are safe and are good for performance. But as expected, people who are experts in other areas do not know about this secret knowledge. And now I want to show you this. These options, these configurations, which will improve your MySQL performance. But before talking about this secret knowledge, I need to tell a little bit about how MySQL works. So what is MySQL? MySQL is database server with 25 years of history. It has popular forks. It's Percona server for MySQL. This is 100 compatible fork with enterprise and troubleshooting and performance features. And MariaDB server, which started as a fork, but now it's going to be independent product with similar features like optimizer or replication, but which are designed internally designed differently. MySQL has replication support from the beginning, and this is important, and I believe this is one thing which made it so popular. And replication it's such a setup, so that's one of service is could be a source of changes. It can accept changes, and other servers replicate these changes, so they could be used for backup, for read scale, and for many various purposes. And also, it allowed MySQL to be high available server from the very beginning. To understand how MySQL like MySQL performance, need to understand that MySQL architecture is layered. It contains its part, and like in case when your application connects to MySQL server, it uses some connectors. It could be MySQL command line client. It could be PHP, Python, Ruby, Java, C program. It could be any program which uses JDBC interface. Once that program connects to MySQL, it goes to connection pool where authentication happens. And some caches like if a connection thread could be taken from the cache or could be created. Then your query goes to SQL interface. Which reads it, parser parses it into the tree, which understandable by optimizer, and optimizer sends like decides how query should be executed, and sends this information to storage engine. Here is also like could be used global caches and buffers, and they could be global or engine specific. And if data could be taken from there, it would be taken from there. And storage engines, they talk with hardware. So practically with file system, and they can also use memory and CPU to resolve the request. Where MySQL is installed in 2020. It could be installed at Berk hardware. It could be installed on cloud. And also, it could be managed by container orchestration systems, such as Kubernetes. For MySQL, there are two Kubernetes operators. This is Percona Kubernetes operator for Percona ExtraDB cluster. Percona ExtraDB cluster, this is a synchronous replication solution. So that you will have, you can write, you can have multiple nodes and you can write to them, and all writes will have same data upon commit. And also exists MySQL operator maintained by Oracle MySQL team. So what affects query performance? So it's when I usually explain how database professionals, people who use database all the time during their working days, I'm telling them the first thing which you need to tune is query, because query that's actually it decides it's actually what you ask database for. So like you are requesting, you may request million of rows, you may run this query write its effective manner or maybe not effective manner. So this all affects your application. But today, since we are speaking about people who manage everything and probably sometimes do not have access to the application itself, we will start from hardware, because hardware also makes a very good sense for MySQL. It's MySQL runs fast and good for hardware. And it actually can run on even on Raspberry Pi, but it's could not handle on small hardware. It could not handle large amount of requests. It's because if you want to MySQL handle more concurrent connections, process more data, it's better to run it on better hardware, properly configured. And one more thing which needs to be discussed is overall MySQL configuration, about what, because even if it's run on good hardware, if it's configured not properly, it could just like use small part of hardware possibilities, and it would be not effective. So you need to understand how to configure MySQL properly. Okay, so what is hardware? How are we going to tune? For bare hardware, it's you have operating system options. It's usually Linux kernel options. For clouds, there is no much things you can do. Go to administrate. It's actually it depends from again which contract do you have. Like for EC2, for Amazon EC2 you can do a lot, and for Amazon Aurora you can just use administrator console and maybe just buy additional options. Percona Kubernetes operator for PXC, it allows to limit resources. It decides how much resources to use. That's, they could be defined as cr.yaml file, and you can limit memory, how much use and maximum usage, and the storage and CPU. What should tune? Which hardware makes sense for MySQL to run fast? This is memory. This is which has caches and frequently accessed data. This is disk, which practically stores the data. CPU, which allows MySQL to support high concurrent environment. And this is network, which is used for sending data between client and server. And first, we will talk about memory, because memory is a very important thing for MySQL performance. Memory configuration, that's MySQL doesn't work when it's swapping. So you need to disable swapping. It's actually for modern kernels, you need to set it to one in case so swap is used only then it's critically needed by the kernel itself and not for other processes. MySQL supports NUMA. NUMA should be NUMA interlead should be enabled in BIOS. MySQL for InnoDB also there is option InnoDB NUMA interleave. This should be also enabled, and it works differently on MySQL server from Oracle and Percona server. On MySQL server, it just enables NUMA interleave for MySQL, and for Percona server, it fills memory with zeros at the startup. That implies a longer startup, but it makes also forfer work of MySQL Percona server for MySQL faster. More memory for MySQL is better. Is that's because when MySQL has optimizations which allows to use memory without with minimal disk access, and then flash flash changes to the disk, and memory access of course is faster than disk access. Therefore, it's better to have more memory. Practically, frequently accessed data should be in memory. It's not always possible because that depends from completely from your application, but if it's possible, that's a good thing to have. How MySQL uses memory? MySQL supports three kinds of buffers. And global buffers, they are allocated up to the limit and freed at shutdown. Important buffers is InnoDB buffer pool. This is InnoDB buffer pool. This is a pool where InnoDB storage engine stores update. Actually, it's could store all active data set and could operate all operations from buffer pool if you have enough memory for this. And then data which needs to be saved on disk, it would be saved in background, which allows very fast operations. Performance schema tables, these are diagnostic tables. These are just, well, they are here for example. They affect, they do not affect performance of MySQL by itself, unless they grow too high and just use memory which could be used for some different things. But that's again, data memory for such buffers is just allocated and never freed until you shut down the server. Session buffers, they are associated with MySQL connections. So then connection starts, they are allocated, and they are freed, and then connection ends. This include, for example, like I put here example, it's connection and result buffers. So it's practically two times by net buffer length. It's a small value by default, but they could grow up to a max allowed packet. So that's, again, it's maybe not very tiny. And also MySQL uses memory for operation specific buffers which help operations to perform fast. A good example could be join buffer size. It's for each table pair, tables pair in join. Like if you are joining two tables, this allocated only once per query. If you are joining 10 tables, it allocated 9 times per query. So again, like you may use it for improving query performance, but you need to be aware if you set it globally, that it can be grow very high. Temporary table size for in-memory temporary tables, it's again, it's for each temporary table. All this data which you can access in memory then finally will be saved to disk. And second important hardware is disk. Disk, MySQL said faster would be better, so use a modern disk. I don't think that spinning disk is an option an option today, unless this is something when you can allow slow writes, since maybe only for some special purpose server. Disk should support parallel writes, so that's you can gain from multi-threaded execution. It also should use battery-backed cache in order to don't lose data in case of power failure. How MySQL uses disk? It stores tables data, that's obvious. It also stores log files. This include binary log file. These are log files which log all updates and use it for the replication on the source server. It includes relay log files which are using on replica server to receive updates. This includes storage engine logs, like InnoDB maintains redo log file which use it for crash recovery. It's also stored on the disk. And it also contains like some diagnostic, like error log, like audit, general slow query log, and other log files which you can use for troubleshooting. It's also some if in-memory temporary tables exceeds the size of the maximum temporary table, it's flushed to disk, and again, that's MySQL uses disk for this purpose. You may put all these things on different disks to explore more parallelization and give more capacity of your hardware. CPU. CPU used to handle parallel execution. Its configuration, it should be set to NOOP or deadline. It's not for default, which is for like user system, so for better performance. CPU governor also needs to be set to performance and not like power save or things like this. More cores is better. It's more cores and is important because actually number of core files limits how much parallel connections could be executed. How MySQL uses CPU? It's for user connection, it creates one thread per connections, but they are mostly sleeping, and CPU uses it only for active threads, that means threads which are executing some useful job at the moment. Background work by storage engine uses threads independently. And to demonstrate you how it works, you may see the difference on this picture. In this case, on the top, there are connection threads, which are perceived by the server. Then they set to the storage engine, and the storage engine executes it into smaller number of threads. If active threads, running threads, is more than storage engine threads, they have to wait its queue. And there are algorithms which allow to tune how this queuing will work. So what happens with threads in MySQL, with active threads? In case if they are less than CPU cores, they are executed simultaneously. If not, they wait in a queue. Even if they executed, if disk supports parallel write, if it supports, its write happens in parallel. If not, it's again thread has to wait in a queue. And finally, last part of hardware which I want to discuss is network. Network is network should be is for MySQL is important part, and should be as fast as possible. And you put need to pay attention for these three items. This is speed of the line, and pay also attention for RTT, which is ping command prints for you. About bandwidth, that means that's like how much data you can send and receive at the same time. And also stability, and MySQL uses TCP/IP protocol, but in case if network is not stable, it has to resubmit packages. And to resubmit packages, it takes time, and it increases time for your clients to receive answers. On the internet connection, it's possible to run MySQL. So what will happen? Clients can't work. They will just connect. They will just receive data not as fast as on local network. Asynchronous replica may delay. It's actually, I wrote here, will delay, but it actually may delay. In case if its source server has active write set, so asynchronous replica will certainly delay. And synchronous cluster like Percon ExtraDB cluster, and also solution available ScienceMySQL 5.7 is InnoDB cluster, they just would not be functional because with default options, which is synchronous cluster. It's synchronous cluster is one node receives and updates, and before returning, it's a commit time before returning result to client. It distributes updates to all other nodes, receives answers, and then only return result to client. If it's done on internet connection, on remote data centers, that's very slow. Defaults are not supported for that. So that's just you will always, cluster will be all the time partitioned. But it's possible to change defaults. But in this case, your application will have very slow response time with this adjusted configuration. So this is a big no to use this. I unfortunately see this in a production environment, but only what I can say, people who do it just stop doing it. How MySQL uses network? It's uses for communication between server and client. And actually, that's everything serving client. It's a regular client, which like application, and it's MySQL server. It's a replication connection IO thread and traffic between the synchronous node. It also communication as server and client, just in case of replications, it plays different roles. And while we spoke about how which hardware MySQL should use and how it should use, so how to configure MySQL to get use of this nice hardware. So what can be configured? It could be configured server options and component options. Like if you remember, MySQL has layered architecture. So components include storage engines, and main is InnoDB, that's the default storage engines, multipurpose. It also has could be plugins like audit plugin, for example. And also could be server parts which are not pluggable, like optimizer or binary login on the source server. Scope of configuration. It's could be global. This is parameters necessary for all server processes, such as location of data directory. Like shared buffers, like an ADB buffer pool size, and like this. Session is control connection-specific parameters, and most of operation-specific options are also have session scope. Here it's on this. These are working QR code. You may use it now, and once. My talk is done. I believe my slides will be available on the conference website, and certainly will be available on my slide share, and you can click this link, and this is working list. And I recommend you to bookmark this. This all MySQL options in one page, so you can search for one which is interesting for you. How to change MySQL variables? You can do it online by running like set command. If you omit anything in square brackets, it would set session variable. If you use global, it will use global variable. And all new connections, if it's also variable association variables, all new connections will use new value, and existing session will use old value. But if it's like variable which affect all the session, it would be changed immediately. And science version 8.0, you may also use set persist command, which not only change global variable, but also store it in automatically generated configuration file. So on the restart, it will be used same new value. You may also use on command line option when start MySQL server. And in the configuration file, which is either in the default location, that's different from different systems, again, a link to the user manual, or specified by option defaults file, and in format, first it's group name, and then variable with value. For Percon ExtraDB cluster operator configuration, you can change it either in cr.yaml file, just search for specifics for Percon ExtraDB cluster and change configuration, or you can use config map In this case, create custom configuration file, then create config map, and restart Percon ExtraDB cluster. If you are using Percon ExtraDB cluster, note it can auto-configure for you in ADB buffer pool size and max connections, but all other options you need to configure yourself. And of course, it will configure like data dir location and things like this, but other performance options, they are just default of MySQL, at least for now. Who can change variables dynamically? Global variables and few session variables could be used, changed in user with special privilege called super. In version 8.0, super was split into multiple privileges, and now it needs to be system variables admin, but also in 8.0 you can use super. Session options can change anybody. 8.0 has restricted privileges. There are not many, like binary log format and binary logging and something like this. This could be require privileges system variables admin and session variables admin. Not restricted options could be changed by anybody. It note that there are no limits, and it's easy to change if user doesn't use it wisely, it could be they could change it to very high value. That you should be very careful when grant people access to your MySQL server. When buffers, then speaking about memory buffers, it's also important to understand why when they are allocated. Force which change control behavior of all server, they allocated at server startup and can start with low values and then grow. Connection options for every connection when connection options and operation specific for every operation when needed, but they could be allocated more than once. Like if you have big join buffers size, it could be allocated multiple times and kill actually maybe even your server. So which are important options? First is like most popular storage engine. It's InnoDB, and InnoDB buffer pool size, that's we talked a little bit about it, and ideally it should hold active data set, so InnoDB will perform all work in memory. That's InnoDB log file size should hold changes, like it's actually approximation. It could be larger, but at least it should hold changes for an hour. Because how it works, then MySQL, when InnoDB like receives updates, it changes data if it's possible, if InnoDB buffer pool size, and writes updates sequentially to InnoDB log file size. That's very fast operation. And once it's less busy, grant freed take data from buffer pool and flushes it to tables. In case if InnoDB log file is small, sometimes they are written in circular fashion, and then that's limit is reached, InnoDB starts aggressive flushing because there is no space to write to log file, and in this case all your transactions are stopped. And if InnoDB log file is too small, this situation could happen faster, and if it's set proper size, InnoDB has enough time to flush all changes to the disk. And here, which is a good way to find out if your log file size is proper size, is use Percona product called Percona Monitoring and Management. It's only open source monitoring system for MySQL, and I am afraid for all the databases. It also supports PostgreSQL and MongoDB. And for log usage, you may see on this picture, red line is total size of the log, and orange bars is how much data was written in during the hour. And you see orange bars are much higher than red line, so this is not good options, and InnoDB log file is set to low. On this picture, that's InnoDB log file set to proper size, to good size, because all orange bars are below red line. So this is very good visual way to find out if your log file size is set properly. In a DBFRET concurrency is either zero, it's default. And if you notice situation, then your CPU usage is high, but performance is low. It may be because InnoDB creates more number of threads than number of CPU cores, and it has Linux kernel has to schedule job between these CPU cores. In this case, it makes sense to limit up to number of CPU cores. This is actually how much parallel threads InnoDB can run concurrently. InnoDB IO capacity with which speed InnoDB will write to disk. Its default is too small for nowadays because it's set for spinning disk. So you can set it up to number of IOPS your disk can handle. It's not exact number because it also depends on how much data you write and some other factor. It should be tested, but that's a rule of thumb. It's like this. Very good explanation actually is official manual. And another option is InnoDB flush method. Recommended option is most cases is ODirect. That means InnoDB writes in flush time, it writes to disk and not stored in cache. It's safest option. Most times it's fastest option also, but test on your file system because some file systems do not work good, like Sun. They do not work good with ODirect, so test it, and this is why it's not default flush method. Another option which can affect performance, it's synchronization options, but this option can compromise durability. So use it better to change it only on read-only replica, or if you can lose data, and I will show you how and what could change. First, its default value about InnoDB flush log at TRX commit is 1. That means what it says. It's flush read log files. It's where flushed at each transaction commit. So that's for full ACID compliance, and you would not lose any transactions in case of a power failure or server operation system restart. Or also not graceful restart of MySQL. In case if it's set to 2, logs written at each commit in flush it per second. But you need to remember. So it's 1 second, very short period of time. But MySQL can handle up to 1 million inserts per second. So that's inserts, it could be a transaction in case if after commit is used. So this is when you set it to 2, you need to understand what you are doing. But it's safe with synchronous clusters because in this case, when you are doing commit, commit also on other nodes, and so that's that they like it's unlikely all three machines will die before flush happens. Zero, it's also less strict with 2. Its logs are written and flushed once per second. And what is important is once per second is not guaranteed for 0 and 2. So it sometimes it could be faster flushing, but sometimes it could be delayed, and so you will lose not just 1 million inserts, but more inserts. Another option is sync min log, that's synchronization of binary log changes. Default is 1, that's again, it's a transaction commit, binary log get synced to file system. In this case, it's no transaction lost. But it may imply performance penalty, like up to 10% of speed for high concurrent environments. So that's to relax it, you may use option 0 when synchronization handled by system. But this option, you have no control how many transactions you can lose. Or you may see set it to N, that's after N binary log group commits, it's groups of transactions which could be flushed together, which were executed together. In this case of power of operating system crash, in this case we are not flushed, this not flushed transaction could be lost from the binary log and You may only rely on engine, but it would be really hard to restart. So you need to understand which number you can set here, but you may set it to some, if you can lose some number of transactions, you may set this to positive value. These options, they are free, almost free. That's table open cache. That's a number of open tables of all threads. It's actually file handle for a table. So that's increasing them when you are seeing the connection in process. These are waiting for opening table. And value of opening tables, they're larger than open tables. Since it's a file descriptor, it's just 4 kilobytes. It's not 4 kilobytes. It's even less. It doesn't use as much resources. And you may see it's very high. A table definition cache is size of the cache for table definitions. Again, increase then when value of status variable, global status variable, open table definitions is larger than open table definitions. It should be less than table open cache, but it's safe to set it high. And you may also increase operating system open files limit if needed. So MySQL can handle so many open files. And finally, query tuning on the server side. So like I told you, that query is heart of your application because you communicate with database using queries, even if you are using NoSQL and MySQL supports NoSQL interface. But they are still queries. They are not SQL queries, but still queries. Data which you request matters. So if you request 1 million of rows, do not expect the query would work as fast as if you request one row, even if it goes, this 1 million rows goes into temporary table. So query execution workflow, it's a query sent, it goes to connection pool. Optimizer creates, its parser creates a tree which is understandable by optimizer. And optimizer created plan how it would be executed and storage engine executes the query. You may not be able to change slow query. It's because it selects, like, for example, just selects a lot of data, and this is data you need. Or maybe it badly written, like left join instead of inner join, like retrieving large result set then discarding. It's not effective SQL, at least for particular MySQL version. But if you have do not have access to the application, it cannot rewrite it, or maybe it's you have to rewrite too many parts of the application. You still have to deal with it, but we still can improve performance, and let's see what we can do. And first thing which to do is indexes. To show you the difference which indexes add, let's see a query which is select name from users, which selects all the users, and select name from the users where ID equal to. We actually need only this record, but it's this query selects same rows in the table. After index added, it selects just one query. So what is the index? Index exactly like in address book is sorted order of unique values in the table, which points to, if table has not unique index, it points to table's data. MySQL support different types of indexes. But what is important, they need to understand that's B3, like InnoDB supports B3. We will speaking about it, B3, and they like left part ordered. Okay, so how to create an index? So use just create index command for a single column, or you can also create on multiple column, and you can also use alter table command, alter table add index. You can specify index name, and you can write. So when MySQL can use indexes? It can use indexes to resolve severe conditions. So like if column is equal to value, and column could be in a set of values, and command is similar, like is value, and on the right side could be anything. But since MySQL used B3 or B3 kind of compatible indexes, this query would not use index because it shows on the left part, and indexes are sorted from the left to right. Same in case if multiple column indexes. MySQL will use indexes where left part equal value or right profile and this like this. It would use indexes with left part equal value or right part equal something else, but would not use indexes for the last row because it has to resolve this value first. For joins, it also will use indexes for this expression. Then it's practically this is same as this query. It's just written differently. So from previous example, you may understand that its index could be used. For group by, it would again use it for, you can use indexes for group by. Can use multiple columns indexes if grouped by left part first, but would not use if grouped by right part first, and would not group by two different indexes. Same applies for order by. It could be sorted by an index by left part first and right part second, but would not use indexes in other cases. It's in 8.0, in 8.5.7 or before, order by left part dischanging and unchanging, it could not be used. By 8.0 supports indexes which could be created with dischanging keyword, and so in this case, this for this query, it also will use indexes. For expressions, it will use index if built-in deterministic expression are used. It's same as like which is returned same value for same argument like floor. It would not use for non-deterministic expression like such as rand. It would not be used for stored functions in UDFs, but MySQL support generated columns, and if you need to use them and still want your query perform fast, you can use generated columns. So how and when add indexes? First, identify which queries do not indexes. Use indexes, for example, use performance schema status variable. It's also available with information and for this variable name of this status variable, it shows some problem with the query. I would not explain in details what all this means. But it shows problem of the query, and these queries are candidates for optimization. Handler is actually shows which actual work done by storage engine, and that's handler read rnd next if it's big. That means query doesn't use indexes, so that's probably also candidate for optimization. Performance schema event statements will show you event statements which are not effective. It's again like for status variable, I selected here all values which shows problem. And one important fact is if row examined is much greater than row sent, and requesting small amount of rows, this is a symptom of query optimization issue. In slow query log, you may also use these metrics. You may also use extended slow query log in Percona server and PT query digest, which could show problematic queries. PMM also you can use like no index used, and you may use this column and search for badly optimized queries. To add indexes, analyze if adding an index will help. It's better to test it on the test server, and if query improves, just add it. Then add the index. But note that add index is expensive operation, so test first, and on production use PT online schema change, which allows to add index without interrupting your other operations. Another option is to use histogram statistics, which are available Science version 8.0. It's collected and used by the optimizer. It could be examined in information schema. Indexes, for example, they are collected and used by storage engine. It affects query execution plan, but not access. So that can change like this, this query of select from A join B, can change to select from B join A, but cannot change like some like to use different indexes, for example. It's more details. It's I did a webinar on histogram statistics and how to use them. And if you are curious, you may check and you may want to watch. To show you a quick difference between indexes. So indexes like we have table with different values number of data. Index this when optimizer discusses with communicates with storage engine which index needs to be used and used value cardinality, and its cardinality is the same for all rows, for all values, no matter how much data each value has. So this could be like if your table has multiple indexes, it could be used like query can decide to use wrong index, for example. For histograms, it shows like for the same data, it shows difference between each bucket. So this is knows exactly like what is the difference between data in this table and could be make more wise, more detailed decision. So create a histogram when data distribution is far from uniform, its query accesses two or more tables and indexes cannot be used. Another option is on the server size is an optimizer configuration. I would not explain what this means, but you may experience it. You may search Box database and you may search which you may find out which optimization options affect your query. So how to work with it? It's turn on and off particular optimization. It's tested. It could be not helpful because some optimization could be not helpful for queries specially tuned for previous versions. Then turn then off, try set optimizer switch, turn off, select, explain select, and compare which with default value. And again, if it helps implementing queries, it's better to use this syntax because default value works for most of the queries, and this tuning needed only for queries which are not good for optimization. And final part is also increase size of optimizer temporary objects, such as temporary tables. You may also change default temporary storage engine to use one which better works for your queries, but usually it's not needed. Buffers for query execution, that's a join buffer size, it's for join conditions not using indexes. Read buffer size is for caching indexes for order by, for caching results of nested queries and bulk insert into partitions. This one is for multi-range read optimization. This is for select into out file or dump file session. And this is for sort operation order by and group by. But be careful, change this only at the session level because if changing it globally, it may lead to increased memory usage, which could be used more wisely for different operations. And to conclude, that's hardware, more memory is better, disk use, modern disk, faster is better, for more cores is better for concurrency, for network use highest speed possible. These are hot options for InnoDB and for server. It's again, slides will be available after the conference, and you can download it and you can use them. And these are query performance options which you can explore for tuning your queries while you cannot actually change the SQL. More information, there are first two links are links to the webinar. They are available on Percona sites about how to troubleshoot. It's not we are we're talking about how to get best of your hardware and configuration, but these webinars about how to troubleshoot if you are seeing some issues, have some problems with that. MySQL query tuning for the ops, it's a similar talk, but about only query tuning. It has more details on how to tune queries. It's again for not MySQL professionals. Percona monitoring and management is linked to the graphical software, which I used for illustration. And final link is Percona Kubernetes operators. These are my contact information. I will also upload slides to SlideShare and will announce everything on Twitter. Thank you.